Hi everyone, and welcome to Digesting History. My name is Sila Sibanda and I will be your host for tonight. So, Digesting History has been created as part of Collections in Verse, a collaboration between Poet in the City, the British Library and Sheffield Libraries, using poetry events and commissions to bring British Library exhibitions to life in four cities across the UK. Now, the work that was done here in Sheffield was inspired by the British Library exhibition, Anglo-Saxon Kingdoms, Art, Word and War. And again, thank you so, so much for joining us tonight. And I know that we are all in our own homes tonight, but imagine that we're all coming together around our digital dinner table to share a night of poetry, film and three courses of conversation. And you are also invited to create your own feast, and I hope that you're eating here with us. But first, to tell us about how this whole event came together is Ruby Baker, the senior creative producer and poet in the city.
Thank you, Sile, and thank you for joining us this evening for Digesting History. Tonight is part of Collections in Verse, a partnership project between Poet in the City, British Library and Library Services across the UK, sharing British Library collections with residents and artists all over the country through community engagement, commissioned poetry and ambitious library takeovers. Poet in the City is a producing organisation connecting people and places through poetry experiences and talent development. You'll find our work everywhere from libraries to art centres, car parks to community venues and festivals to music halls. And community collaboration is at the heart of everything we do. Our work in Sheffield began in summer 2019. The three incredible poets that you'll hear from this evening started their creative journey after visiting the British Library's Anglo-Saxon Kingdoms exhibition. From experiencing the histories that were presented within the collection, each poet came away with ideas that they would explore with communities across Sheffield. We partnered with library staff to connect with local people in Woodseats, Highfields and Firth Park, gathering inspiration from almost 200 people that we met through listening workshops, pop-up interventions, and more informal conversations with shopkeepers and library visitors. The new poetry has at the heart of it the local stories and voices that were so generously shared by the people of Sheffield. Digesting History was set to be a theatrical feasting experience inspired by the early medieval period as a chance to bring people together, as was tradition, to share food, riddles, music and poetry. We were a week away from delivering the event before the pandemic hit. Over the following months, we renewed our purpose to bring people together to share food and poetry. And whilst we might be separated in our homes this evening, we hope that we can experience this feast of discussion, film and poetry together here online. Sheffield Libraries, along with library services across the country, have played a critical role during the pandemic, offering frontline services to local communities. Library staff have provided support to people shielding, and Firth Park Library transformed into a food bank. This has highlighted the vital need for libraries and their teams, alongside community leaders and networks. Another one of these important groups in Sheffield is Open Kitchen Social Club, who we are delighted to be supporting as part of tonight's event. They provide food, peer support and a place to meet for destitute asylum seekers, refugees, migrants and anyone in food or social poverty. Through the generous donations that you have made when signing up to Digesting History, we were able to donate over £1,700 to their incredible work. Please continue to donate tonight and support their work through the link in the chat. Our artists have worked with us to find inventive ways to reach audiences in a time where we've all had to reimagine the way we work. Interactive arts company The Bear Project designed the poetry parcels that some of you received through your letterboxes. Our brilliant poets, Rachel Bauer, Kayo Chingonyi, and Joe Chris, responded to the work with communities with creativity and compassion. And Elin Lee, who I've had the delight of working with, mostly virtually over the last few months, has so sensitively curated the poetry and the wider project into a new film that we are thrilled to reveal tonight. Thank you also to those joining us this evening that took part in this project and shared your stories with us. You have inspired all of the work that you will see. We have some wonderful treats in store for you, so sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Thank you, Ruby. Thank you so much for telling us how this whole project came about. So tonight, we're going to be hearing poetry from the three commissioned poets, Rachel Bauer, Kayo Chingoni, and Joe Chris. We're also going to be screening the premiere of Where Two Rivers Meet, a brand new film created by Elin Lee. And then we're going to be tucking into three courses of conversations with curator of the Anglo-Saxon Kingdoms exhibition, Claire Bray, alongside PhD linguistics researcher, Joanna Blakey, and Dan Marshall from Sheffield Libraries. But before we get into all that good stuff, we're going to be hearing music from Rosie Hood. Rosie, take it away. That was Rosie Hood with her song Adrift, Adrift. Rosie, thank you so much for sharing that with us. It is now time for the premiere of the commissioned film, Where Two Rivers Meet, created by Elin Lee. It's a film that tells a story of collections in verse, the collaboration between the poets, libraries, and local communities in Sheffield.
Thank you. Many moons ago, in a forest in old England, two great rivers met. This offering of fertile ground for Anglo-Saxon seeds birthed language, stories, and libraries of the mind. This is the tale of the journey of that place, of its people, poetry, and food. A tale of love, survival, and a common humanity. Of words, migration, and of places where things once began.
Hang around. This town will mind you of how little you need. To speak and hear the echo. Breathe good air amid mid-afternoon's demands. As a water droplet falls from spring leaves, indiscriminate endearment, fleck of grace, it lands. I see you.
On the show today, we're going to be hearing from three poets who have been working out of Sheffield Libraries to write a brand new series of poetry called Collections in Verse. Joe Chris, Rachel Bauer and Kayo Chingoni will be sharing some of the stories behind the poems, as well as telling us about how they were inspired by the people of Sheffield as well as the Anglo-Saxons. We are joined by poet Kayo Chingoni, who's going to tell us a little bit about the Anglo-Saxon Kingdoms, an exhibition that took place at the British Library, and how it inspired his recent work with the communities of Firth Park. Kayo, some of the first poetry written in the English language came from the Anglo-Saxons. So what inspired you when you visited the exhibition?
The English language as we recognize it now started to emerge, and that's what I'm fascinated with, like what has endured, what has been thought of as a really powerful way of saying something that has longevity. To see that history unfold before your eyes is a really miraculous thing. I think that's the thing that drew me most to the exhibition.
So how did you bring that inspiration back to Sheffield, and in particular to Firth Park where you were based?
I think in Firth Park it was really wonderful because there's such a connection to Sheffield dialect speech. I'm thinking in particular about the ways that the community is one of the most mixed. So of necessity, the language in Firth Park has always been a mixture of different influences. And then if you add that to Sheffield dialect speech, then some really amazing things open up. And I think for me, that's what's really fascinating about Firth Park. You have this mixture of people from across the UK, so there's a lot of different UK accents, and then you mix that with accents from around the world and words from around the world, and you get this really rich soup of language.
Now then, bit muggy, innit? That's proper Atticus, that.
I married an Arabic chap who was working in a steelworks.
Hello, Flower. You got out water? That area were nice then. Corporation water, mind.
I'm not closing, love. We're open while our four. You're all we're saying. We all make mistakes.
You know, language is so interesting because, like, my accent is a mixture of the Zimbabwean dialect as well as South Yorkshire. So when I greet my mum or a female member of my family, I usually say, "Hiya, Ma." Now, "Hiya" is a common greeting that is used in South Yorkshire, and "Ma" being something that you call an older woman instead of calling their name. So can you give us an example of how all of this informed the poetry that you wrote?
I think an East Yorkshire expression for really heavy rain is "siling down with rain." But because we were in Firth Park, of course, there were people from Hull and from the East Riding of Yorkshire who have that particular word as a through line in their speech. And as a consequence of being there, they then inflect Firth Park speech with those phrases, those words.
It's raining. Hats and clogs, sprats and cogs, mats and pogs, bats and frogs, cats and dogs, hammer and tongs. Hell for leather, like nobody's business, like Billy-O. It's sing it down, it's biblical. I'm soaked through, need snowshoes, the road's loose underfoot. I'm drenched, sopping. From beanie to stocking, just wanted to do my shopping, but still it keeps on dropping, showing no signs of stopping. A pain, an inconvenience, an almighty strain. It's siling down with rain.
There's also something like loppy, which was really interesting because it's considered a Sheffield word, but it also has a relationship to New Zealand as well. If something's loppy, it's kind of like dirty, mucky, filthy, covered in dust, that sort of thing. And so at some point, someone came from New Zealand and influenced the ways of speaking in South Yorkshire. And that was really interesting to complicate our notion of what Britishness is and was.
Dust begrimed, soap skeptic, dirty, dusty, crusty, something on which to build if you can see past the surface. Waistcoat of filth. Uniform of an ancient guild.
So when you were in Firth Park, you were based at the library, where I believe you attended children's groups, coffee mornings, and got some crucial local insight from the library staff. So what was it like hanging out as a poet in the library?
There's an ephemerality to the population of a library, which I think is wonderful. There are people just popping in to print something off or just popping in to look something up or using the library as a kind of community hub as well. And I talked to some of those people as well about their relationship to language. So it was just a real mixture of everyone who passed through the library. I had a lot of fun, I should say, interacting with words in that way and arguing with people about whether it's ginnel or genel or ginnel or genel was really fun. And you know, the jury is still out on that.
An interstice, a quarter tone. Last known whereabouts of missing persons the world over. From the Old English, the coast's open moor pointing the way to the Whale Road. Gap in the teeth of a terraced street.
The city was named by its river, one of five and seven hills. But what connects its people in troubled times? What waters flow when streets fall silent? This tale now takes a most woeful turn.
Now, just as the poetry project Collections in Verse was coming to an end, the coronavirus pandemic hit. With the national lockdown in place, various community eating projects in Sheffield pulled together to redistribute food parcels to those in need around the city. Firth Park Library repurposed itself to host a food bank. Before he left the studio, I asked Kayo Chingoni on his thoughts on this.
There's just the sense that the library is an area of public space where it is okay to be and not to buy anything. I never feel so connected to my local areas when I move through the library, and that's a kind of shame of these COVID restricted times, that you can't be in kinship with each other as a community in that kind of way, that you can't be suddenly brought together with somebody who you didn't expect to be brought together with and experiencing a common humanity. For me, in its best sense, a library is a commons, you know, a place to exist in commonality and share ideas. And that's what literature is anyway, that's what a book is, that's what language is for, to share ideas, to communicate, to have your words stand in for you when you cannot be physically present. But it's so important to have spaces in society where people can be for free, where they don't have to buy anything, where they can borrow and lend and share in that way. And I think the social good that a library does reminds us of that currency, which is sharing with each other. For no other reason than somebody might be in need, so you share. And the library just crystallizes that sense of connection from and between human beings, which is something that we've always craved and needed to survive.
Powerful words there from Kayo, and such great work happening at Firth Park Library. Now, my next guest is Joe Chris, another one of the poets commissioned to write new work for collections in verse. Joe, I understand that you were inspired to think about identity when you saw the Anglo-Saxon Kingdoms exhibition. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
We're still struggling with these issues of national identity today, and you know, finding out and reading and researching about all the different kingdoms that were emerging around this time. I think the Anglo-Saxon period offers a really interesting beginning point for us to explore some of these themes about what nationality means to us.
And you were based at Woodseats Library. How did you get some of the local people involved in exploring some of the themes with you?
For some time I was sat at the front of the library, trying to look as friendly as possible. Luckily a few people were up for kind of talking to me and having conversations and kind of interrupting me as I was writing poems. And that was a really interesting stepping off point for some of the poems. And also I was running young writers workshops. I met one of the young writers there called Django, and we did a number of workshops exploring ideas around kind of identity and nationalism. A lot of people have a sense of feeling English or feeling British, but they don't necessarily know where this comes from. And I try to kind of capture this idea that we kind of almost inherit our culture through language, really. It could be bits of film, it could be stories our parents have told us. That's where our kind of own sense of identity comes from.
England falls between the gaps in our sentences. This green and pleasant land curls your vowels. A few miles in any direction is enough for a new accent to stiffen your upper lip. Yet it is not just sounds, but the shape of our thoughts that are inherited.
By day, we are a nation of shopkeepers who no longer keep shop for the world. The factories have closed down, and now cathedrals of glass and steel trade our future in algorithms too removed from us to understand.
The past is unwritten, a place where we look to find a thread for our new beginnings.
Yet this land we call kin does not recognize our tongue. It has belonged to names before us, and will be written by those that come.
Ah, that is beautiful. Can you tell us a bit more about your poem Inglalande? I hope I've said that correctly. Is it an Anglo-Saxon word?
So the poem Inglalande comes from essentially the Old English spelling of England, and immediately kind of triggered this thought of football crowds when people were singing Inglaland on football terraces, watching England play football. I really like this idea that they're almost kind of pulling on this old ancestral world of old English language.
Terrace choirs sing for glory, chanting Inglaland against a floodlit pitch. They are resurrecting our past, pulling on ancestral shadow lives that only remain in coiled genetic code, and the splinters of language reshaped by the vibrations passing between ear and tongue. To name a place is to call it into being. Each song is a reckoning, a moment of rebirth. Yet when we paper chain ourselves back from now, past generations of living memory, past speech, what is it of Inglaland that remains? How do you pull yourself together back from a song you can't trace?
telling this nation's tale? What language do you hear? Prepare to dine on untold stories, a feast of queens and names, with guests too bold to sit in silence. Listen with compassion and care.
My last guest from the Collections in Verse project is Sheffield poet Rachel Bauer. Rachel, welcome. I want to ask you, what did you take away from the Anglo-Saxons exhibition at the British Library?
So there was lots of books and gold and lots of wealthy people, I guess, represented there. But I was really interested in the lived experiences and the everyday experiences that you didn't see. I was struck by the absence of women. There was a brooch that, which had an engraving around the edge with the different women who'd passed that brooch on. So I was really starting to become interested in women and what it might have been to actually live as a woman then, and also what it might mean to pass something on.
And how did you turn those interests into a project for Highfields Library?
So when I came back to Sheffield and to Highfields, I knew that I wanted to hear from local women so that if you came to an exhibition of this time, you would see women's experiences and voices represented in that exhibition. So really my idea was just to listen, to create a listening project in which I would listen to local women, listen to voices, listen to experiences, listen to lived, ordinary, everyday experiences.
Listen to scarves, books, twisted rings, to the kalim, rugs, piano keys. Listen to rain falling in glass beads. Listen to us living in what we leave.
I asked people to bring objects, and lots of those objects have made their way into the poem. And those objects tend to have a story connected to them. The idea was to weave together those stories about what people brought to Sheffield, what kind of comes from Sheffield, but also what people would like to leave.
Listen to lyrics, fish, photographs, to gold worn smooth, to rubbed sea glass. Listen to rubies saved from the blast. Listen to us weeping as we laugh.
And I believe that you worked with local artist Eleni Stavrou. Now, Eleni was on our show last year, so I'm curious to know, how was she involved in your part of the project?
So Eleni came along to one of the workshops that we ran at Highfields Library, and she was sketching what was going on, and she sketched the objects that some of the women brought, and she also sketched some of the workshop exercises and activities that we did, passing the wool around. She wove all those into this beautiful tapestry.
Listen to crossings, loss, friends bereft, fusion curries, cakes, pudding bread. Listen to lovers, birth in bed with death. Listen to us changing in what we left.
Woven throughout the poem is the experience of Queen Emma. The famous thing about her is that she had two sons by two different kings, and it also brings up the daughters that she had. So the daughters are often excluded from her narrative, and we just hear about these two sons. So I've tried to include her experience as a mother of daughters and sons, and what it might mean to birth a boy basically for the throne. Goda guards her brother even now, begs me send her instead, hacks her hair short, hums lullabies of mountains, lavender, turtle doves, a warrior to his cause. The narrative of the poem travels and imagines the second marriage as something that she thought would be positive and would be kind of redeeming, but also turns out to be quite a violent relationship. They're at it, outside the window, unholy woman. I give as good as I get, knuckle fights in the bedroom, fingers crusted thick with emeralds to scour his cheeks with shame. And they whisper bitch, even as he forces. He turns away from my sow bladder belly, navel protruding, spitting in disgust. I like my women clean. He means young, uncreased, ready for war.
Rachel, thank you so much for being on the show. It's been fascinating hearing about this project. You know, listening to voices from the past and the present, from the British Library in London to local libraries here in Sheffield, Highfield, Woodseeds, and the Food Bank in Firth Park. So Rachel, you're going to play us out with a section from your poem where Queen Emma conjures Lady Macbeth. So can you introduce it to us before you leave us with your literary food for thought?
Queen Emma is by herself kind of grappling with this experience of what am I going to do? I have to send this baby to war, and I've kind of produced him for him to be taken from me and for him to be killed. So it's a bit about grappling with that experience of being a mother and a queen at the same time.
Drink, girl, drink. You know they'll forget your labour, the bearing down, splitting the bread of your body to writhing kid, offal to dust. What are these cries of lack of air? Where are the eyes, the guts, the liver for wolves and crows without women to sculpt blunt arms and little legs? Deliver them to earth. Ready your eyes for the sting of losing your sons. Singe your hearts. Dash frothy heads on yourself to the tap of small palms on your breast. Suckly milk that first grin. Stamp that light from your eyes. Make no mistake, there'll be oxfat for the lamps, antlers for the knives, the bones of giant fish for scribes, but still you must offer the entrails of your child for free. The world flocks with ravens, beetles, lice, but shh, the guard sent warning on my door. I will not let it, I'll offer myself in chainmail, sail my ships, hide my sons, my daughters, my kings. By God, they will not die.
So our story ends with nourishment for bodies, minds and souls. A time to share, reflect, refuel. Set a place for the past in the present. The future is yet to be told. Make space for chance meetings. Build libraries from rivers. What stories shall we pass on? What traces are left behind?
That was Where Two Rivers Meet, created by Eileen Lee. What a fantastic film. I want to know, what did you think about it? Please write it in the chat. And I'm delighted to say that we're speaking to Eileen now. Eileen, welcome. First, I would love to know, tell me about the title of the film. Where did it come from?
Yeah, sure. So Sheffield itself started during the Anglo-Saxon times. It was originally an Anglo-Saxon settlement, but actually you know, Anglo-Saxons came and they settled where the River Don meets the River Sheaf. And then I guess they must have kind of like lived there quite frugally for a few hundred years. And I think it was about like 400 years later, and then someone else came along and then built a castle and a church. And the castle used to be actually at that point where the Don meets the Sheaf. So the idea behind the opening of the film, where you see the forest, the wood shots, and you hear the narrator telling the story really of the beginnings of Sheffield. So it's kind of almost like a creation story for the city. So the narrator sets that up, and then you see the wide shot of the city as it is today. And then you hear the Kayo's poetry, which is the kind of like sets the scene for the whole film.
Wow, that is so interesting. Now, can I ask, how did you work with poetry in the film?
So when I was approaching this film, and I had the poetry on the page from the three poets from the Collections in Verse project, because I was mindful that I was making a film that told the story of the wider project. It was a kind of I'm trying to tell the big picture story, if you like, not just the story of, you know, using one poem. It's got to be, you know, the collections of poetry. So when I was reading the poetry, I was looking for any kind of threads that run through all the poets' work. And what really struck me was this concept of traces, this idea of what are the traces that we leave behind, and what are the traces from the past that live within the present, and what are the traces that we are actually creating right now that are going to remain in the future. So I thought that could be quite a nice sort of visual motif that could recur throughout the film. So that's when you see kind of like little close-ups of you know, leaves blowing, or especially when they're contrasted with kind of like big panoramic shots of the city, and then you cut through like a macro shot of a like a mushroom in the field. So they're kind of like you know, the little minute traces of life there that we see, that we evidence, that we witness amongst this sort of like the big sort of like the massive, the context of the city. But then also things like the image of the telegraph pole, when you hear lots of voices. I quite like the idea that, you know, at any one time, you know, there are sort of thousands of conversations probably going on, people talking on phones, text messaging. So that image of that telegraph pole and all those voices is kind of an illustration of the concept of like the traces that we're leaving behind in terms of all those conversations that we're having.
You have some beautiful shots of Sheffield Central Library. So what was it like filming that?
Yeah, filming in the Central Library was amazing. I mean, it's quite an iconic building in the city. And I'm sure, you know, most people that live in the city have kind of popped in at some point in their lives, maybe even through a school visit. Because it is just, you know, it's a little haven like in the center of the city. So obviously it's free to go in. And as you could see in the film, it's got all this beautiful wood paneling, these massive high ceilings and big windows, you know, quite a Harry Potter type of a library vibe there. And, you know, and we were so lucky to have the run of the building to some extent, because it was obviously we were filming in the middle of a pandemic between lockdowns. So the library was open, but had sort of limited, restricted opening hours. But amazingly enough, you know, the staff kept running a book lending service all throughout. But it meant that we could, yeah, we went down to the basement, to the stack, as you call it, where there's like this amazing archive of books down there. And, you know, in the Central Library, they've also got a theatre. There's also an art gallery, the local studies area. So it's, you know, it's a proper old, you know, big old library with lots of like nooks and crannies and very in different sort of like facets and spaces to it. So it's a real special sort of magical place to film.
And like everyone who's watching the film now, how does it feel watching it completed?
Well, to be honest, it was a real relief actually to watch the film finished and all come together, because it's quite a complex film in terms of the sort of lots of layers of narratives. So I came up with this concept of the story being told through the radio program, and then we would hear and see a radio, in the kitchen, where open kitchen, we're preparing the food that would be kind of running through as a thread throughout the film as well. But then you'd also pick up a radio in the van where the van driver is delivering the food parcels. And I guess from the outset, that was always going to be, quite a challenging thing to pull off filmically. So I was taking a creative risk. So I was quite relieved to see it all come together. And it worked. Yes, thank goodness. But it was also, an exciting process to go through to really push the form of documentary filmmaking as well in that way.
Thank you so much, Eileen. Thank you. And I want to know from you watching, what do you think about the film? Please share it in the chat. The starting point for this project was the British Library's exhibition, Anglo-Saxon Kingdoms, Art, Word and War. We are now going to hear from the curator of the exhibition, Claire Bray, to tell us more about what you would have found in the exhibit.
Good evening, and thank you, Sile. And thanks also to Sheffield Libraries and Poet in the City for the opportunity to share a little taste of the Anglo-Saxon Kingdoms exhibition with you this evening. The exhibition covered over 600 years from the 5th century to the 11th, focusing on their art, language and literature and history. This is Spong Man, and he's a unique ceramic figure who greeted visitors to his 5th century world at the start of the show. The exhibition looked at the Anglo-Saxon kingdoms in the context of their connections with each other and with Europe, from Ireland across to the Mediterranean and beyond. The oldest manuscript on show came from North Africa. These 4th century fragments are copies of the letters of Bishop Cyprian of Carthage. This manuscript may have been brought to England by the North African scholar Hadrian, who became abbot in Canterbury in the 7th century. The exhibition also included major illuminated gospel books produced in Northumbria after its conversion following the arrival of Irish monks. These books included the famous Lindisfarne Gospels, which, like the North African manuscript of Cyprian's letters, show the reliance of the early church on books imported from abroad. Another famous import is this Italian gospel book, probably brought to Canterbury by St. Augustine on his mission from Rome in 597. The event tonight is celebrating libraries, and the exhibition also highlighted some of the great libraries of the Anglo-Saxon kingdoms. One of these was at Bede's Monastery of Wearmouth Jarrow. This library was founded with books brought back from Europe, but the monastery was also a great centre of book production and made this giant copy of the Bible known as Codex Amiatinus. It was taken to Rome in 716 and had not been back in Britain for over 1300 years until it was displayed in the exhibition. The exhibition focused on the written evidence for this foundational period, including key works such as Bede's Ecclesiastical History of the English People, the First Charter, the First Original Letter, as well as manuscripts of the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle. All of this evidence is crucial for tracing the development of the early kingdoms. By the later 9th century, King Alfred was calling himself King of the Anglo-Saxons, and in the 10th century, the Kingdom of the English emerged. The exhibition culminated with Domesday Book, documenting a vast amount of detail about the organisation and wealth of 11th century England before and after the Norman conquest. Also running through the show was a story of the development of the English language. And this brooch from Norwich has been repaired at the bottom, and on the back is an inscription in runes: Luda repaired the brooch. Early brief uses of English like this were shown alongside the first extended text written in English, the Laws of King Ethelbert of Kent from around 600. The exhibition also traced the development of literature in both English and Latin. And the highlight was the first display together of four manuscripts, which together contain over 75% of all surviving poetry in Old English, most famously Beowulf on the left. Men are more visible in the surviving historical evidence, but the exhibition also looked at women's lives. This 7th century pendant from a woman's grave was found only in 2014 in Norfolk. Emma of Normandy, wife of Kings Ethelred and Canute and mother of two kings, is seen here with her sons in a manuscript containing a very partisan account of her role in the period of Scandinavian rule in England that followed Canute's conquest in 1016. And this is the will of Winflad, a well-to-do 10th century woman. It documents her lands, her houses, her clothes, tableware and jewellery, and paints an incredibly detailed picture of her life. At the other end of the social spectrum is Gwenndgith, a Cornish slave. Multispectral imaging on the left here of a blank page in the Bodmin Gospels revealed erased copies of documents freeing slaves, including Gwenndgith. And this single newly revealed source is the only record of her life. And this reminds us that brand new evidence can sometimes be found not only in archaeological excavations, but also within the books held in our libraries. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Claire. The exhibition sounds so fascinating, with many different themes to explore. Now, Joe Chris, you were one of the poets who got to visit the exhibition. So what was it like going to the exhibition, knowing that you were going to take the themes and ideas back to the community of Woodseat?
I think it was a really interesting experience that, you know, first sort of start of the project where you're going into the exhibition, thinking in your head that this is going to be the starting point of of a whole process where I'm going to have to write poems, work with different members of the community, and then present work. And I think you're kind of almost trying to discover and interpret bits of the exhibition in the context of thinking about both writing poems and also thinking about how members of the community in Woodseats might find themselves specific points of interest or specific themes that they might recognise from the exhibition. So, you know, when I was walking through the exhibition, you're trying to understand the exhibition with the frame of these things sort of going on in your head. And I think, you know, thinking about a lot of these different objects, you know, there was lots of Bibles, you know, there were sort of bits of jewellery, and there's this mixture of both, I think, sort of very precious items that have been sort of handed down, like the bejeweled sort of religious texts, and also sort of accidental items from pieces of jewellery or swords or things that have been lost or buried over time. And I think the things that really came clear to me looking at the exhibition was these real themes of identity and nationalism, and thinking about this, is this real period of history that people's identities start to change and flip. You go from, you know, the establishment of these kingdoms into these nation states. And I think, you know, we're going through a period at the moment as well of rebalancing what our own national identity is, as we understand our own identity, I think. But, you know, individually, I think every person has a real history of migration in their own family. And also we have sort of Brexit happening in terms of people, you know, perhaps thinking themselves maybe less of Europeans or more of Europeans, depending on how they're responding to it. And so I think there's a real kind of parallel, I think, between almost the Anglo-Saxon period and today, about thinking about who we are, what our identity is, and where we're headed.
I think we are now ready to listen to your poetry. Can you tell us what we're going to hear?
So the poem you're about to hear is called Life Reduced as Evidence. And it starts with an epigraph, which isn't in the recording. But the epigraph is, life can only be understood backwards, but it must be lived forwards. And I suppose really, you know, the poem is almost, is my take on that, really. It's about, we often try and understand, you know, the present really in the context of the past. And this poem is me projecting 1,500 years into the future and imagining how our present time now is going to be understood by the future, really informed by the sort of discussions and sort of workshop process that I did with the young writers group at Woodseats. So yeah, hope you enjoy. This poem is called Life Reduced as Evidence.
A museum assistant in a long white cloak wears gloves as they pick across finds tagged with my DNA profile. This is no Staffordshire hoard. Almost everything is plastic or glass. The oldest items in the collection are toys. A beaten grey mutant biker mice from Mars. A small plaque next to the find states it was found during renovations at what was once known as Greenwich Park, presumed lost at a family picnic in the 1990s. A small collection of early 21st century music encased in reflective metal discs. A note states that traces of my handwriting were found on the laminated album sleeves. A 3D projection hosts my digital imprint from this time. A school photograph, university records, bills, and Facebook messages rotate in the air. A pixelated video screen plays short clips from Game of Thrones and Friends. A voiceover states that Joe was born in the early Anthropocene. He was one of the 20% of world population at that time that had ever boarded a plane. Italicized quotes mark world events as turning points. As people move to the exit, they shake their head, think of dinner and Sunday dread. The world is neither giver or gift, mother or captor, but a living thing. The land will never forget these few hundred years. They will be plucked like splinters from the land, like a body rejecting teeth.
Thank you so much for sharing your poem with us, Joe Chris. It's now time for us to dive into the second course of conversations. We're going to have PhD researcher Joanna Blakey, who's going to be sharing her research into the social change that has taken place historically, but more recently in the last 100 years that has impacted Sheffield language and dialect.
Everyone, I'm going to be talking to you a bit today about some research that I'm doing at the University of Sheffield into how social change in the city of Sheffield across the last 100 years in particular has impacted the way that linguistic variation plays out in the city. So how different people speak depending on where they live and what their background is. And yeah, and a lot of the interesting stuff that have happened in the history of where we now live in Sheffield have led us to the kind of environment that we have today linguistically. So if we start by going back to when Yorkshire first entered written history, it was in 71 AD and it was occupied by the Romans. And then the first Anglian settlements were in the 5th and 6th centuries. And because of this, the base of the local dialect in Yorkshire is Old English. And then the next big impact on the local language that we use here was when Scandinavian settlements came in the 9th century from Denmark and brought some Danish words into the vocabulary, such as the word flit, which you probably hear around Sheffield to mean like to move house or to migrate to another area. And yeah, so Yorkshire was the nucleus of Scandinavian settlement. So most of the impact on the dialect is from Scandinavian languages with like a Germanic base. And Danish settlement brought place names such as ones that end in B and Thorpe, like Whitby and Scunthorpe. And we also see evidence of Anglian examples and place names that end in tin and ham. And then if we move on to when Yorkshire dialect first really entered writing in the form of poetry, this happened in the 17th century. Before that, the only kind of hint of like Yorkshire language that we see is in Chaucer's tales. So yeah, the first Yorkshire dialect poetry came out in the 17th century, and it was at a time where people were starting to kind of celebrate local dialect and acknowledge the fact that that these local forms of language exist. And then in the 18th century, there was a bit of a pressure on the kind of upwardly mobile middle classes to speak in standard English grammar. And this kind of manifested in the publishing of loads of standard English grammar, like books to try and prescribe the way that we use language. But then 100 years later in Sheffield, we saw the publication of the Hallamshire Glossary, which is an example of like one of the biggest and first collections of local Sheffield features of speech. And this was done because people started to think in the 19th century, after this sort of pressure for languages to become more standard and to be more intelligible to people in different parts of the UK. People were worried about our local language kind of dying out and us losing the local like features that we have and the elements of our dialect that we enjoy. So yeah, the Hallamshire Glossary, we see that released. And so zooming in on Sheffield in particular, it entered recorded history in the Domesday Book in 1086, and the areas that were in there were called Hallun and Eskerfeld, and they were the geographical areas that we now know as Sheffield. And this kind of place, because of the topography of where we are, it wasn't a very desirable place to settle. And this is where like the topography of Sheffield starts to influence the kind of character of the place and the inhabitants, because it meant that once they had settled there, it was a very difficult place to conquer. It's sheltered by the highlands, and this gave Sheffield a character of being like the largest village in England. It's like off the beaten track. There's like a sense of isolation and obscurity, which was kind of like lingering around the city. And we still hear things like that today, where people will say that Sheffield's the largest village in England, and everybody knows somebody else. And that's something that's really stuck to like the character of Sheffield. And in the past, Sheffielders were claimed to be hard-headed, disliking of change and self-reliant, which was a result of like long centuries of border warfare. Around this time, if we look at like pre-18th century, Sheffield was always like off the main roads and river and rail routes. But then in the 18th century, there were huge like developments in infrastructure, which meant that we became more connected to the rest of like Northern England, and there was like routes to London and stuff. And more people started to come into Sheffield at this point. And there was a 20% increase in population in each decade of the 18th century. And then Sheffield becomes a city in 1893. And at this point, the kind of topography of the place and the fact that Sheffield is built on seven hills and we've got five rivers running through the centre, this was like something that meant we could have like huge success in the steel industry. There was also like local coal mines in neighbouring towns and villages like Barnsley. And yeah, because of that, we could import coal into the centre and then use water power to run steel firms and manufacturing factories. And then this is where like 100 years of rapid social change starts in Sheffield, because going into the 20th century, Sheffield was like a northern industrial powerhouse, and obviously like loads of steel was being produced to help Britain in the war, and everyone that lived in Sheffield kind of like chipped in and got involved with the steelworks, and all of the kind of like family dynamics and social spaces in Sheffield were like centered around the steelworks. So you had local close-knit communities of Sheffield people that lived and breathed the steel industry, and because of that they all used really local features of language that were kind of fostered and maintained in environments like this that were really close-knit. And these all seemed to like emerge in the east end of Sheffield, so where Ratcliffe is now. This is where this kind of like hub of like the industrial sector was, and where all the workers lived. And this is because the wind used to blow the smog from the factories from the west of Sheffield to the east, which meant that it was a less desirable place to live, but therefore more affordable for working class families. And then the factory owners lived in the west, and this was the beginning of like a social divide that we still see today in Sheffield, where the working classes and those in like manual labour jobs, broadly speaking, tend to reside in the east of Sheffield. And then in the west, there's more people that are professional and more likely middle class, and also people that are less likely to have been born and raised in Sheffield, but maybe they moved to Sheffield in the past 50 years when kind of geographical mobility like increased like tenfold with all the new like transport infrastructure in Sheffield, and the fact that the two universities were thriving and they still are, and there's 5 teaching hospitals in Sheffield. So there was like desire for professionals to come and live and settle in Sheffield and work. And we have one of the highest retention rates of students as well that come to Sheffield to study and then end up sticking around to live and work in the city. And they tend to reside more so in the west than the east. So how this starts to impact linguistic variation is that in the east of the Sheffield, where we have these little pockets of people who inherited a really strong sense of Sheffield identity, because like myself, my grandparents and my great grandparents like had links to the steelworks and used to like work in the factories, and my great grandma like worked in the kitchen like feeding all the workers, and they have really broad Sheffield accents because of the fact that they grew up in areas in like Ratcliffe and stuff where the local accent was like maintained and encouraged amongst the communities that lived there. And my nan and granddad that are still around today still have really broad Sheffield accents. And yeah, mine's been lost a bit from living away from Sheffield for quite some time. But yeah, every time I come back to Sheffield and I get in conversations with locals, like it starts to come back out. But yeah, like if you go to like the west of Sheffield, you'll be much less likely to find local forms because of the different paths that people have taken to come to live in these areas. It's influenced their linguistic choices, and they're less likely to want to use Sheffield features. But people that inherit local identity are much more likely to carry on sounding like a local and wanting to be recognised as Sheffielders. So yeah, I hope you enjoyed hearing me talk about this research and the kind of things that I've been finding out. And this is still a work in progress. I'm still working on this data at the minute. And I'm going to be putting out blog posts on a blog that I run called Steel City Spiel. And I'll be, yeah, sharing more information as findings emerge in this research. So that's the place to go if you want to keep up.
Thank you, Joanna. Thank you so much. Now, Kayo, this research really resonated with the conversations that you were having in Firth Park Library. So what was the process in engaging local people, and how did that inform your development of the poetry that you wrote?
So when I got to Firth Park, when I got to the Firth Park area in general, one of my motivations was to try and strike up conversation with people as much as possible. And so I spoke to some people while I was walking through the park. I spoke to people at bus stops, on buses. And also when I was in the library, I met with the coffee morning that happens on a Friday. I met with them and tried to get a sense of their experience as speakers of Sheffield dialect and people who've lived in Firth Park for a long time. So a lot of what I ended up doing on the project was drawn from those conversations with people about their relationship to their language. So I spoke to people in cafes as well. I spoke to people in the local kind of like one-stop shop as well. So there was a mixture and patchwork of different conversations that I had, but the through line was those conversations with people from the coffee morning, because they had this kind of long perspective about that local area, about how words and phrases migrate from one place to another. And it was just really fascinating to get their perspective, because language changes so much between generations, and so it's really valuable to speak to people who have access to all those different generations and to learn from them. And talking helped me to find the center of the project. And I realized very quickly that the center of the project for me was around language and dialect.
And once you engaged with local people, what was your process in telling their stories in your work?
I think it's really crucial when you're creating particular kinds of work, when you're coming as an outsider to a situation, I think it's crucial that you don't make your perspective as an outsider the central perspective. And I think because of the different kind of politics of class and migration that come into play in Firth Park, it was important for me to center the voices of people from Firth Park, because that's not my experience. I have a different, you know, I have a different experience from a different part of the country, you know. So I had to go there as someone who didn't know and discover things. And I think I really lean on a phrase which I'm paraphrasing really, but which is no work about us without us, basically, because like there has to be that collaborative spirit when you're doing work of this kind. Otherwise, it's just you forcing your perspective on something. And I think ultimately, as a writer of poetry, discovery is one of the central things that you're engaged in. If every time you start a poem, you already know where it's going, there's not much point in doing it. So for me, I had to discover a bunch of stuff in order to make this both exciting for me as a writer, but also ethically, in order to enter into the spirit of the area on its own terms, rather than forcing my perspective on that space. And I'm sure my perspective comes in more than I would like, but at least if I'm trying to place my perspective as a secondary concern, then something more interesting and dynamic comes out of that.
I'm curious to know, what did you learn working in Firth Park in particular?
One of the things I've been thinking about is how a very small area can have a deep impact on the shape and identity of a wider area. And I've been connecting that to the work of Joy White, Dr. Joy White, who looks at youth culture, and in particular inner city London culture, through music, through grime. I was thinking about a thing that Joy White is interested in, which she calls hyperlocal demarcation. And she means by that the way that a very small region is marked out by its own particular way of speaking, its own traditions and history. And it strikes me that Firth Park is a hyper-local part of Sheffield. You know, Sheffield has its own culture and history, which is broad. And then if you go to Firth Park, it has its own kind of pockets of history and culture, which you might not access from just visiting the city centre of Sheffield. You have to venture out and explore different parts in order to get a full picture. So going to Firth Park and spending so much time there was really valuable for someone like me who, you know, I thought I had a deep relationship with Sheffield as somebody who's had some connection to the city for, you know, 15 years at this point. But there's always something new you can learn by venturing into a different part of the place where you live or the place where you visit. And yeah, that's a really valuable thing that I learned from the project is, yeah, to go to places that you've not been before. Places that you might have not overlooked necessarily, but might not have taken the time to get to know. And I think if you spend that kind of quality time in a place, what you learn from it is really valuable.
Thank you so much, Kayo. Can you tell us the poem that you're going to share?
This poem is called Love. And I feel the word love has a very particular shape and texture in Yorkshire. And I was really moved by that. So this is Love.
Hang around. This town will mind you of how little you need to speak and hear the echo. Breathe good air amid mid-afternoon's demands. As a water droplet falls from spring leaves, indiscriminate endearment, fleck of grace, it lands. I see you.
Thank you so much, Kayo. That was beautiful. Thank you. Now, I want to know which part of Kayo's poem really resonated with you. So please share it in the chat. Would love to see that. I think it's now time to introduce Dan Marshall. Now, Dan is from Sheffield Libraries. Dan, I've been hearing that Sheffield Libraries have been doing an incredible job during the pandemic. Could you tell me, how have you adapted during this time?
I think in Sheffield, you know, we've probably mirrored the work that has been taking place up and down the country in public libraries, really. Yeah. Libraries have, I think, proved themselves pretty adaptable and responsive. In some ways, they maybe had a bit of a moment because they've stepped up to some very real needs. I mean, in Sheffield, we were quite quick to embrace the digital side, and we poured resources into our online collections, and you know, that meant more ebooks, more audiobooks, more e-magazines, that sort of thing. And we saw thousands of new members kind of rush to use those things, which was brilliant and really showed the need early on. But we also, for the first time, embraced online events. So we had some curated programs of author talks and creative workshops, local history and that sort of thing. We had an adventure book festival, a rebellion series, a hope season, which again proved great, and loads of people coming to enjoy those things online. But alongside that, and perhaps more important actually to individuals, was the many sort of more community focused interactive sessions, the creative writing meets, the poetry meets, the craft groups, the shared reading, things like that, where people could come together and actually meet other people. You know, when you're trapped in your own home and you're desperately lonely and you just want to be with other people, you know, we facilitated that. And the fact that those events were booked up in a flash really showed the need that was out there. We also produced a podcast, which was brilliant and allowed us to interview some really interesting people, some great authors and speakers. It's been a lot of fun. Once able, we started running our order and collect service. So although people weren't allowed to come into the libraries and actually browse the bookshelves and take take books away like that, they could tell us what they wanted, and we would prepare bags of books for them, and they could come and collect them. And then there was our home library service, which never really stopped. So the home library service is a home delivery service for people that are unable to leave their homes. It's been running for years and is a real lifeline. Mostly serves isolated older people that are housebound. But you know, we also found ourselves having to adapt, and we saw our people and our spaces being used differently. So a large number of our library staff were redeployed early on to help with shielding calls, and they were making telephone calls to people around Sheffield that weren't able to leave their homes. I know that lives were saved through some of those calls. You know, they were hugely important, and I think we're really proud of that. I think it kind of continues a tradition of that sort of community focus and those public library values. Think back to Sheffield Blitz, when Sheffield was bombed heavily and people came to the Central Library for information. It was an information point, it was a coordination centre, and it was also serving hot food and drink and all that in those days afterwards, which maybe mirrors what was taking place at Firth Park Library throughout the pandemic when it was operating as a food bank. So yeah, we've learned a lot, and we've been quite busy. We adapted and will continue to do so.
And also, particularly during this time, what role do you feel that the libraries play within community?
Sure. I mean, I think libraries operate as a kind of anchor point within a community. Be that a central library and a focal point within a city centre, or a district library. And in Sheffield, we have very distinct communities. You know, it's often referred to as lots of villages within one bigger city. And they're an anchor point where the doors, in normal times at least, are open to anyone, and there's something very special about that. And in normal times, you could go into one of our libraries and you would see people accessing IT support, you could see an author talk, you could see a baby time session for new parents, or a reminiscence session for isolated older people. And those things really, really matter. It's hard to put a monetary value on those things. But trust me, you know, someone that's worked in libraries a long time and seen the impact that they have on individuals, they really matter. So I think libraries help people connect with their place, with their community, and with each other. And then there are the books, you know, the sheer magic, the power of the written word, and the fact that we issue millions of those up and down the country every year, and that's not to be sniffed at. You know, libraries are the nation's most democratic cultural provider. There is nothing else that compares in terms of engagement. No theatre, no sporting event or gallery comes anywhere close to the level of engagement that libraries have, they offer. I think recently, you know, in Sheffield, you know, the engagement with the digital stuff has been amazing, and really demonstrated the need and this awful sense of disconnect that we have, the epidemic of loneliness, all those things. And it's been great that we've been able to respond to that. But it's also, if we're being honest, the digital is a poor substitute for the real thing, for the in the flesh interaction. So I'm looking forward. I think I probably speak for Sheffield Libraries, and probably libraries up and down the country again. We said we can't wait to have people back, can't wait to open the doors. And you know, we see the need there, which is as great as ever. And I think this has really revealed how we can make a real difference in responding to all these challenges post-pandemic. Yeah. I'm looking forward to doing so.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you. And Rachel, your research was about connecting to the communities of women across Sheffield.
It was just such an honour to listen to people's stories. I was really moved by the way that people came along and just shared really openly and really wanted to tell their stories. And I think sometimes when you create a space which is kind of safe and supportive, in which we invite people to tell their stories and their experiences and share their pain and their sorrow and their pleasure and their joy. And it's just amazing what happens, I think, in that space, and people connected with each other as well as with us in the project. So it was just, yeah, it was just kind of an honor really to bear witness to those stories and to be gifted them and to share that space with people sharing so generously. And people took it really seriously, and yeah.
You know, during the film, Kayo said a line that I absolutely loved. He said, "Words stand in for you when you can't physically be present." And to me, it really related to your poetry, and in particular, to the tapestry that was made that is going to outlive us. So how did you feel about the process of documenting women's stories and voices into that history?
I mean, that's a really beautiful way of putting it, I think, that words stand in for us when we're not physically present. And it's a really huge responsibility, I think, to ask people for their stories and to then make something that will go beyond our moment. I was really struck in the exhibition about how people still were present through words or through traces, inscriptions in the margins, inscriptions on the edges of on the back of a piece of jewellery. And I think that actually these things do go beyond us. And what I wanted to do was ensure that for our moment now, that we do inscribe those, that women's experiences and women's histories, and that they're not only in the margins, but that we inscribe them centrally in our histories. So asking people for their stories was just was an honor, but also it was a big responsibility. And thinking about how their experiences are captured in the poem, are also captured in the tapestry, which Eleni's made. I just hope that these artifacts, these texts and textures can go beyond us, and that the history that we are actively creating together in Sheffield will not have the same kind of absences as histories in the past, I guess.
Thanks, Rachel. Can you please introduce your poem to us?
So my poem's called "Listen, I've Heard Many Old Tales." And it's a long poem, and it's about women's experiences, women's lives, basically. It's about what women pass on, what's passed on to women, and what women wish are being passed on to them. And it's a poem that's set in two places. It's set partly in modern Sheffield, responding to the stories and the experiences that women gave to me and shared with me. And it's partly a poem set in Anglo-Saxon period, reimagining the women's lives and experiences then, particularly, as you'll hear in the poem, you'll hear the voice of Queen Emma. And so the poem's an imaginative recuperation of her voice and her experiences, not as a queen, but as a woman, and what it might have felt like to be mother to two heirs to the throne and wife of two different kings. So this is "Listen, I've Heard Many Old Tales," and I want it to be for all the women who shared their stories with me in Sheffield. Listen, I've heard many old tales. Listen to scarves, books, twisted rings, to the kelim, rugs, piano keys. Listen to rain falling in glass beads. Listen to us living in what we leave. Listen to lyrics, fish, photographs, to gold worn smooth, to rubbed sea glass. Listen to rubies saved from the blast. Listen to us weeping as we laugh. Listen to crossings, loss, friends bereft, fusion curries, cakes, pudding bread. Listen to lovers, birth in bed with death. Listen to us changing in what we left. Listen, I've heard them say, by God, not one but two. Two sons by two kings, whispering in the market, tittle-tattle, in it for the gold. Ignorant of the six small gods I have pushed into this world, five, bawling and one, silent as snow. Female diplomacy at its best, not that they'd know. Yes, two sons by two kings and battle scars to prove it.
crinkled paper and dough, while their fathers outlawed in it, whoring, expects me to raise this one, lightless, veal for slaughter, but no, that must wait. Let's start with the beginning. Ethelred, the unready, just a footnote now, but never unready for me, would never let me be day and night, not that I minded, insisting on my pleasure first, swan fingertip feathers, crying into my neck, ill-advised, unprepared for battle, but wouldn't you be? Brother murdered at 10, crown bending your willow neck, barely a signet. His mother was stricken for her first, would never look Ethelred in the eye. He resented it in the end, sent her away, 7 ships from the north, ransacked, waste. I refused to be his mother, but he unearthed my lover, even wanted me moon-bellied, burning on top with our first, and still they mutter 2 sons by 2 kings, fickle as figs. But didn't they cheer below my velvet drapes for Edward, firstborn, dark-nestled, mouth wide o for milk, starred hands patting, the round weight of down in my hand. Listen to scarves, books, twisted rings, to the kelim, rugs, piano keys, listen to rain, falling in glass beads, listen to us, living in what we leave.
Thank you for sharing your porridge with us. And I also want to say a big, big thank you to all the collaborators and speakers who were part of Digesting History. Thank you so much to Porridge in the City, the British Library and Sheffield Libraries. I have really, really enjoyed being a part of this project, listening to all the wonderful poetry and having some great conversations. I literally have learned something new about the city where I live. And I also want to say thank you to you for joining us tonight on our digital dinner table. I hope that you have all enjoyed your dinners. And now to play us out, here's Rosie Hood. Thank you.
my fate, the die is cast, the answer no. My wings are clipped and I am bound by the light of Halley's glow. But the jackdaws beckon, join our